TGL Tavern Tale Season Spring. My name is Nimshan. I'm here with Raven and Lothar for the last match of the day. We had a really long 2 days. The first day, the Swiss, 5 rounds. Today we had 7 matches, some show matches, a battle between decks without any attack almost.
Yeah. They died to fatigue.
Yeah, they did.
It was fatigue from the beginning.
Yeah.
The last match for today is Arnie versus Athanas.
Yeah. It's going to be a good one. Interesting one to finish the day because these are two like lesser known players, I would say. You know, we've seen some of the bigger names earlier on, and you know, we've got matches tomorrow like you know, Tice versus Powder, for example.
Yeah.
But really cool to see how these guys do.
Yep, for sure. Like, we have no idea what are they playing. They might bring some funky decks, you know.
Yeah.
Or just face Shaman 3-0 again, like we just saw in the previous match with Vince against Tracking Style. Right?
Absolutely. Or just bring the standard lineup of Zoo, Druid, and Secret Paladin, which seems to be one of the most popular ones overall.
Yeah, well, it's crazy efficient, right?
Yeah, so it is.
Why not?
It's a good one, especially if you normally don't have that much time to study Hearthstone, because you study and you work. So, you know, not everybody's a pro player, and it's really easy to forget that. Like, we are praising Tice a lot, being one of the best players here, but Tice does it full time. It's his job. He basically plays all the time, and he's sponsored, and he's a salary. A lot of those players here, they did take their chances in the qualifiers, and they have other lives. They have work, families, and not that Tice doesn't have a family.
Well, when you think about it, all of those pro players started from the same point. Right?
Yeah, they did.
They did share time with other activities and play Hearthstone at the same time. I mean, for most of them, at least that was the case. I know that for Tice that was the case, and for myself that was the case, so there's a lot of examples of that. So maybe there's another pro player here looming in the shadows for now.
Yeah, definitely. This type of tournament for a player who can get pretty far and eventually even win the tournament is a great chance to make a break from the scene and start being a pro player, because people can actually notice him. Like, hey, Arne is one of those guys who's actually doing really good in the tournament. He takes it, and then we want to have him on a team, or Athanas as well. We've actually had a lot of Greek players in this tournament.
Yeah, and just talk about that, especially like this is one of the tournaments that you definitely want the breakout performance to be. There's no invites. It's been open. It's been a pretty grueling like experience to just like battle through this many rounds for the players that are still in the tournament. And you know, if one of these guys wins today, then he's got potentially another few games tomorrow against some really tough opponents. So it's definitely a good proving ground for these newer players. And I wouldn't be surprised if one of the more like the lesser known players, you know, performs well and potentially wins second place, third place, even top 8 overall. This is just a good opportunity for them to get picked up by a team, and then, but like you said, potentially get that Hearthstone career rolling if that's what they want.
Absolutely. That's why I really want to know more about those players. And we did ask those players about, we asked them some questions. So let's see what they have to say.
I'm Arne Hazrums. I'm a Hearthstone player. I'm playing for the team Ruse Gaming.
I'm Jonathan Asiou. I'm from Greece. I play Hearthstone for Oblivion Crusaders.
I started playing Hearthstone in the late days of beta, when I got my beta key. And it was more of a game in between my other games, because Hearthstone games don't take very long, and I didn't really like think about going competitive back then.
Right now we have a lot of players. We don't have a big name at the moment, but I believe in a few months we will have many players in the big scenes.
I mostly like the format, because in the summer, so the DreamHack Cluj-Napoca, there was a group stage double elimination, and I really liked that format. And now in this PGL, they use the Swiss format, which I also really like, so I find that very good for PGL.
I think there will be 1 or 2 months to be adapting this format, to understand completely this format. We'll see new decks, better decks in my opinion, more combo in the deck, and I'm pretty excited about that.
I think the wild and standard formats are pretty refreshing for the game, so it keeps everyone interested. It also gives Blizzard more design space, so we could see more meta shifts, which also ultimately will bring out the better players.
Antanas versus Arne, where Arne actually has experience. He got, I don't remember exactly, was it top 8 or top 4 in Cluj-Napoca, but he was definitely featured, and he was sitting there in that chair already. And his opponent, Athanas, well, this might be his first big LAN tournament.
Yeah, and again, like we were saying, and like he was saying in the video, actually, his team might not be the most well-known team, but they've got some good players, and definitely believes that, you know, going forward, they're going to start making a big name for themselves. And, you know, this is a pretty good step for the team already, you know, him getting this far, a really good performance overall. Even just, you know, even if he goes out this round, it's still a great performance. So a lot to be proud of there, you know, like, you know, flying the colours there for his team. And look at the lineups there. Athanas has Druid, Paladin, and Warlock versus the Mage, Paladin and Warlock as well. So
wow, oh. Richard is like favoring.
I think we have a lot of Greek viewers. That's for sure. With so many great Greek players in the tournament.
Probably because of Tsibu.
Passively. Or like a Baus.
Yeah.
60% for Twitter as well. So definitely got the Twitter following. Whereas Gosu Gamers have ruined it all, and he's definitely rooting for Arnie here with 52%.
All right. So lineups. Pretty standard from Arne, as you mentioned, Raven. And then there is the mage for Arne. Do we know what that mage is? Do we know anything from the Swiss part?
Well, the Swiss part is not really that important after they could have changed the decks, right? So it might have been Freeze Mage, but now it might be Tempo Mage.
Yeah, I would love to see Tempo. I'd really love to see Tempo. I like the deck a lot. But it's difficult to get past how powerful Freeze Mage is overall. I think it's just the better deck in general.
Absolutely.
And the official said that, like, the Flame Wakers are horrible right now.
Unit said that. The Flame Waker deck is quite in a difficult situation right now. It might be good versus Druid, but versus Zoo, it's terrible overall. And there are many other decks that are countering it.
Yep.
Okay. So the game will be ready in just a moment. For those guys, it's a really important game, not only because it's an elimination game, but they will double the money if they win. Right now, they're guaranteed $500. If they win, there's 1K. And also 2 HCT points. And last month, it was enough to have, what, 6 to qualify
seven,
for the prem?
It was 6 seven. In EU, I think.
6 in NA, I think. And was EU it? Was 7. I think NA, you just needed 5 or 6.
Oh, I thought it was 6 in EU. I might be wrong.
All right.
But we are going to see the Paladin lineup against the Druid. And this is really interesting, actually. So something I want to talk about is the first deck select, especially in Last Hero Standing. So there's sort of weird mind games where if that is Freeze Mage, then it's always a good deck to start with because you know, your opponent probably will want to play a hard counter into Freeze Mage. Mm-hmm. So they need to wait and not necessarily lock in that hard counter. But then you can go a step further where going, my opponent will know this with the Mage, so is he just going to start Mage, try and get one win? And if you get one win already, you're feeling pretty good, especially in Last Hero Standing when you can then counter pick and then potentially get the lead. But as you sort of motioned then, Lothar, when we saw the Mulligan, the Fel Reaver is definitely an interesting card.
It is an interesting card, but it's kind of stopped in its track because of like Secrets and Noble Sacrifice, especially. You can burn like million cards for the Druid, which is not important unless you run out of threats, because the burn is like completely unimportant if you still have cards to draw and finish up the game, right? It's only a factor when you're running out of threats and you basically run out of cards. But for now, Arne has no idea that there might be a Fel Reaver.
Well, Fel Reaver, I think, is also signaling that this is basically the aggressive Druid. So we might expect also Knife Jugglers, Druid of the Saber, and some other aggressive cards that are in this deck overall.
Yeah, this is a huge choice now, though. He can innovate Shredder into Shade of Naxx for a curve, or he can just Hero Power, test the Secret, and then innovate out Fel Reaver next turn.
I would go for the Palted Shredder almost always here.
Yeah, I will also.
Oh no, I kind of like this play. Because if you know it's not a Noble Sacrifice, like his turn two is going to be Mini Bot, Juggler, you know, your normal turn two. And then you put out Fel Reaver. Like, what's he going to do turn three into Fel Reaver?
Cog Hammer.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's like the one card, right?
But then really? You have Keeper of Ulduman.
Yeah, into turn. Yeah, okay, look, if you're going to say, if he has the perfect cards, when there's one card that locks him out for this first turn, I think it's worth
actually
the play.
Actually, he has Keeper of Ulduman right now.
Yeah, and the Cloakhammer as well, Raven.
Yeah, all right. Well, he can silence through the Cloakhammer.
No, like, to be honest,
shut up, guys.
Actually, right,
shut up.
Keeper of the Grove will be awesome here if he doesn't trade. Like, look at that. Yeah. Keeper of Ulduman coming down, makes the Felrevir free, so you can kill it with the Knife Juggler. But if you don't kill it, and then the Keeper of the Grove silences not only the effect, the drawback from the Felrevir, but also silences the effect from the Keeper of Ulduman, so it's 8-8 again.
Yeah, but you definitely kill it, I think, and you're happy to mill six cards.
Do you mill it? I mean, do you kill it?
You mill it, you kill it.
You mill it,
you mill it, or do you kill it?
Why would you? Like, you do understand the Keeper of the Grove is a possibility. But by the way, I kind of agree that playing a Felrevir is an okay play. It's absolutely not a misplay because you're testing your opponent. Do you have an answer? Like, if you don't, you basically just lose.
Yeah, and I think also, you know, and I am going to defend my point, of course. But like the Felrevir, because he has so much follow up, like he's not all in on this whatsoever.
Absolutely.
Like it could have paid off massively and just won him the game there and then. But oh no, he has to follow up with Shredder. You know, he has the swipe. He has the Shade of Naxxramas as well. So, you know, and the Keeper of the Grove. So he had options. It wasn't like we saw the earlier game where it was literally all in on Lotheb, and that was it. Whereas this is much safer because he has so many different like follow up.
Yeah, and even if Felrevir would connect to face once, you're still fine.
Yeah, it's huge.
You're the aggressive druid.
Oh, it's the favorite turn to Balder Shredder. I mean, just half of the damage, right? And you curve out perfectly afterwards because you gain the advantage of playing the Felrevir or what happened? Nightwell? Oh,
yep.
Great card. you just have the damage. When you think about Deathrattle, you probably have almost the same damage as the Felrevir, the same faster than the Felrevir, and you curve out later on, and you still put off like really big threats every single fit.
Yeah, I just think that the thing that pushed it for me was the secret. Because if that was Noble Sacrifice and you play the Shredder, and then next turn you want to carry on curving, so then the Shredder runs into Noble Sacrifice, and then you just suddenly feel a bit delayed. That's all, maybe give the Paladin a chance to catch up. But anyway, that time is long gone now.
Yeah, now
so,
we face
let's look at the board now. So there is a Noble Sacrifice in hand, so that was a relevant segue, I think. And he does have the mini bot. He has the option of muster mini bot, but I don't know. I kind of like the Noble Sacrifice to force the Avenge proc.
Yeah, definitely.
What's the third secret now? I missed
redemption.
That as we were arguing over Felrevir.
He played Redemption.
Oh, okay, so he has Redemption. Okay. Yeah, so he gets the 2-1 back after the attack and then gets the Avenge. And to be honest, like out of all the targets, there's two targets that Avenge is pretty damn good on, like the 3-4 taunt or the mini bot. So.
It's so interesting because the hand that Athanas has is basically what you want to have versus Druid. Like you have keepers, you have swipe, so you can deal with most of the stuff that versus Paladin. I mean, like whatever Paladin throws against you, you should be able to deal with it. But on the other hand, is this really the hand he wants as an aggressive Druid? Or is he in fact the aggressive Druid?
No, I think that there's been people running the list where it's like pretty much Druid with Felrevirs. As opposed to playing, you know, like the Lepinomes, the Sabres, and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And, you know, you see, like, you know, he might have them, you know, that we've just not seen them yet. And we did see a Savage Combatant as well,
yeah.
I think, in the opening Mulligan. But I've definitely seen some people run lists with just like Felrevir as an extra addition.
Because the 5-drop is flexible. Like, people play Belchers, people play Azure Drakes, and
people
play Felrevirs. Gaara would be so happy to just run this Druid.
And sometimes as well, like, because Druid has the ability to innovate, like sometimes a early or even just a Felrevir on 5 just wins you the game when they don't have the answer. Like, you know, that's completely valid, and sometimes it just happens. So
yeah. Well, for now it looks really good for the Druids. Can Paladin get Mistress Challenger if he is forced to go for? Oh,
it's not a bad either.
Yeah, but he's still forced to go into Muster. I feel.
Yeah, the problem is as well, like, Muster, even with Avenge, like, the swipes... does the swipe clear the board, or does the Avenge proc as it's cleared?
If everything dies,
then it doesn't
proc it.
So in this situation, the Master of Battle is quite awful.
Yeah.
So, but you don't have any other options. If you want to win, race against the aggressive Paladin, because
tough.
You know, against the aggressive Druid, because you know it's aggressive, right? You saw the Felrevir.
Well, you suspect it, but we just discussed it's possible that it's not an aggressive one.
Then why would you play Felrevir?
As as a threat card instead of Azure Drakes or Sludge Belcher to just surprise your opponents overall?
I don't know, man. I don't know.
Well, we've seen some weird decks today, so be a believer, Lofar. There's nothing else that indicates it's actually an aggressive one.
Well, the light will kind of turns it around. Here.
The control druid.
This was all planned from the beginning.
It warps the perspective that this druid is an aggressive one. Yeah. Because he has a light wall.
This just doesn't make sense.
He's back to full health. What?
This deck is better than priest at healing.
Apparently.
Oh. Ah, so there's the leopard. Okay. Okay.
See? Never get fooled by the Fel Reaver.
We didn't say it definitely wasn't. We said there is a chance.
Never get fooled by the Fel Reaver.
The Fel Reaver mind games.
I think the only deck that wasn't full aggro that was playing Fel Reaver at some point was Zoo.
Zoo is kind of like an aggro, I think.
Well, it's not exactly an aggro deck, but it took advantage of having like big stats on low-cost minions, right?
I think it worked best in Mechmage overall.
Yeah, I think it's okay. I mean, there was a point as well. I think I saw some mid-range Hunter decks actually run Fel Reaver, which is pretty cool.
Suddenly, Athanas is actually getting those aggressive cards. Well, what to do here? So, Dr. Boom, can you respond to this?
Do you just play Druid of the Claw, Lepinome, Saber?
Charge everything.
Yeah. Smock.
Well, you can.
There's no nice way to kill Boom, right? Without like feeling too bad about running everything.
Can you even kill the Boom?
You can.
Is that? I mean, I know you can, but is this a reasonable option?
Yeah, that's what I mean. There's no good way to kill Dr. Boom.
I think it's not terrible, actually.
You think?
Charging Druid of the Saber with Shade and killing it with the Keeper. That's basically 6 mana you're spending here.
I'd be so scared about using Keeper on turn 7, though. Because if like, that Tyrion then comes down, that's going to be rough.
That was really unexpected.
Oh.
That costed him dearly.
Well, now he can heal the second bomb, silence the boom, and I guess play.
Do you even bother silencing the boom? At this point, does like does 3 damage change anything? I don't know. I think you save it, especially Tyrion could come down next turn, and that's you know just as scary.
True, true. But there is just repentance for now.
Oh, look at that!
Called
well,
it.
Well then, really good read from Athanas that the Tyrion can come.
I mean, I think the issue is even it, you know, yeah, you can silence it. It's still 6/6 though. So
60 damage total.
Yeah,
17 even.
Just 2 turn lethal straight away,
oh,
which
man.
Is weird from 30 health.
Poor aggressive druid.
Yeah, the aggressive druid wasn't aggressive, so.
Yeah.
It had Fel Reaver on turn 3. It should have connected to face.
Give him a link.
Yeah, I mean, like, however much the Fel Reaver play didn't look great there early on, like, the Paladin had the perfect answer, like, on curve. Like, you know, there's only really that card that answers it that hard, I think. So,
and Peacekeeper?
A secret Paladin's really playing that card?
Sometimes they were.
Okay.
Right?
Okay. I mean, if we're going to list all of the cards that beat Fel Reaver.
I mean, Paladin is one of the best classes to actually play against Fel Reaver. Because you have you have Repentance, you have
Keeper of
Ulduman, you have
Cockhammer.
Cockhammer, sometimes Beacon Hunter.
And the Peacekeepers are also...
Noble Sacrifice, a lot of secrets, just to mill like 12 cards for 4 mana.
Absolutely.
Right? And then coin out something.
But the game is not over yet. Actually, if... does he go for face here? If there is a Savage Roar, what happens?
You Savage Roar is 10 damage, so that's still not enough.
Well, plus 7.
So there's Noble Sacrifice down, right?
No, actually, Savage Roar would be enough, right? If you don't trade the minions.
No, I think it's 1 off. Unless
no,
I'm
it's 2.
Oh, there's 19.
With Hero Power?
With Hero Power is 1 off.
1 off,
yes.
Yeah. But Noble Sacrifice is down, right?
Yeah.
Unless I miss something.
Yeah, yeah, I would.
So
you just go face and
yeah,
2 turn lethal.
Yeah, 2 turn lethal, why not?
Because now you don't have a 2-turn lethal. Unless there's a competitive spirit. Wait, did I miss that?
There is Avenge and Noble Sacrifice. So, in theory, Avenge will get procced. So you should have 2-turn lethal.
But we are not counting the Light Wall.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, true.
Yeah, and with only one, with only the druid damaged, then it auto-heals the druid, right?
You actually could have killed the Light Wall less than instead of the Narrasis.
Yeah, so that's true. The mana doesn't actually do much, does it?
So what can Athanas do? Is Athanas trying to set up a sub-Druid, like play Druid in stealth and go for face with two damage? If he attacks into a 2-1, he'll go...
Can he afford to trade? Like, I mean, I suppose the Avenge is going off anyway, right? Because there's Noble Sack and Avenge down.
Yeah, like, so, and you need to attack, like, there is no choice. Alright, let's see where Avenge lands.
Interdusting.
Doesn't land on dude.
Oh, it's not Avenge.
It's competitive spirit, right? No, wait, what?
No, it's Repentance.
Oh, wow. It is the end of the day, guys.
Oh, you're right. Yeah, actually. There was Repentance for so long there. So this game is far from over, actually. Now it's all about the draws. If there are secrets being drawn through silver, well, 4 damage.
Do you actually just true silver down the 2-2 and then kill the 0-5 with Tyrion?
Yep.
Because otherwise, this Lightwell is just going to... It's already got pretty, you know, good amount of value. And with being able to just, like, you know, push out the hero powers every turn, like, yeah, the druid can hero power him back, but you still create that board for that turn, like, they maybe can't be able, aren't able to squeeze in.
Oh, man. This game is closer than it should be. Fel Reaver. Hello!
Oh, that's actually good.
Yeah. It forces a double trade out just to leave it alone.
Oh man, just taking damage? Like, can you really leave it alone?
Probably not on this health, no. Because you don't, you know, if the weapon had 2 charges, tough one, but I think you have to just
keep a roll demand top deck.
Oh my. Oh, well, that's. Is there any noble sacrifice left?
Yeah, I think there is
one
more.
Noble sacrifice.
Leper Gnome, the Burn.
Actually, good cards are burned. I mean, good cards for the Druid player, because they were basically useless.
No Force, no Savager.
So do you go face now that you have that much additional power on board?
Can you set up Lethal for the next turn?
Well, you have no secrets.
Yeah, you put yourself to 21, though.
You force... I think you do attack face, because you will force a trade. If Fel Reaver doesn't trade into your minions, you win, right? This is 10 damage right now. So you put them to 12, and you have exactly... 13 next turn.
Yeah, to coincide with the hero power.
Yeah, that's exactly because of that.
I think you do, yeah.
So you force a trade on... you basically will ask the Fel Reaver to attack into one of your minions.
Yeah, I mean, the other option that you've got to weigh up is, yeah, you know, it's 2-turn lethal, but the druid's top decking, so if he just kills his Fel Reaver, he still has a 6-6 and tokens every turn, so and then just carry it through on there. But yeah. I like this play, just you go aggressive.
It's still tough, though, because... Well, right now the druid will have to trade into your minion because he dies otherwise. But if there will be something to deny you the kill, and Fel Reaver would connect to face, you're in trouble overall.
So if Fel Reaver, it's probably going to go into the 6-6. Do you actually use the weapon then to kill Fel Reaver and then trade the 6-4 into...
That depends on the draw.
Depends what you draw, yeah.
Yeah. I'm just saying that, like, as a base. Obviously, if you draw something like...
Yeah, like you
bad
lethal,
you then yeah, sure.
Yeah, but like something like Keeper of Ulduman, it really depends what you will get.
Or a Belcher.
Yeah, shoot a Meebot, then you know what to do as well. But I think from the Druid's perspective, you definitely need to kill the 6-6. And you can also kill the 1-1.
Yeah, I think there's no reason not to, right?
Yeah.
You take the 1 damage regardless, you may as well just kill it. You have to... So that's like... That's just lethal if he doesn't kill the 6-6. So.
And you have only target that you can kill because it's a 6-6 instead of a 6-4.
Yeah.
Which can be killed with his wife. Abusive Surgeon, well...
Close!
By the way, Abusive Surgeon?
Right, Abusive Surgeon?
Rewind? I guess.
Okay.
Sure.
I mean, sometimes...
In the beginning, good, right?
In the beginning, it was a thing.
Oh man, that hurts. Thanos definitely distressed by that burn. That was
okay, guys. So with the Abusive Sergeant draw, do you trade both into both minions, or do you not care about the juggler?
Wait. So if you actually can you go face?
I think you just now go face.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, he's still on it's the same issue as last turn, right? He set up lethal, so the Fel Reaver has to trade.
Oh, no!
What?
Well,
what are you scared of?
You did kill a lot of cards, right? There is
no more
double
force.
Force
of nature, and it's... Swipe is on bad. Like, really, really bad.
How about
swipe.
Ancient of Lore?
I don't think it'll play it in this deck, right?
Swipe?
Ancient of Lore.
No, Ancient of Lore is another card, but yeah.
Okay, so you kill Tyrion, you kill the 2-1, and... You hope that you will get a good draw.
How many cards has he left? Like,
not that many, actually.
Four? Something about that, I think.
This game is really interesting. I would not expect this game to go into something more.
He has one Innovate left.
Shredder.
Shredder versus Shredder.
But the dudes!
Yeah, well, this is interesting. This is like important now because the 1-1s are always one ahead now with the Druid. They can't just one for
swipe.
One with the hero power.
Second swipe. No? Oh, Savage Roar. Okay, so the swipe is the last card.
Savage Roar. So, go face.
Can you win?
Wait. Here, Savage Roar. No. You have 5. You need to deal the 4 damage to the face. Your opponent is at 14. Swipe next turn to 10.
I think there is no way to win this. Like, right now, because you are alive if you shapeshift, you should probably go for face. Savage Roar and go face. If you know your last card is a swipe, you have to hope that your opponent doesn't kill the Shredder, and you still can't win. No, you will be able to win if you would go for that.
Wait, is it a swipe? Isn't it an innervate?
I lost track of all the felt.
Yeah,
the
I did lose. Wait, what about Savage Combatant? Is that the Savage Combatant?
But that doesn't change much.
Shield me, bot.
That's a good card.
Yeah, it's a decent card.
Confirmed right here, right now. Minibot.
Okay.
Good card. In case anyone didn't know.
Can help you win. And it's a playground swipe.
The only option the Paladin has this turn. Yeah, he's playing around swipe with this minibot play.
That's really good. Not Bagel!
Now, what is that card? Innervate? Yeah, it is an Innervate.
You see, Innervate is not that good.
Attention.
Innervate is not a great card, Lothar.
Yeah, when it's the last card. It's like the preparation. Yeah, it's a bad card when it's the 30th card.
So he's one off lethal,
yeah, fun fact.
Right?
Fun fact, he's actually not dead yet. No, wait, actually, he's dead to fatigue.
Yeah.
Right?
Well.
No, one off. Okay, one off.
Yeah, he's one off this turn, but yes, he's dead.
But I really wanted to see if that Pagan would trick hard. No! Oh, man.
Got it.
Arne got it. That was a convincing victory by a Paladin.
It was a very odd game. Interesting he took that version of Druid as well. Maybe just wants to sort of shake it up a little bit. I don't know whether he was playing that in Swiss or not. But, yeah, just an interesting choice overall. We've just seen the power of, like, just standard mid-range Druid overall. So
he almost had it. Actually, if the cards would be milled in a different way, he might have just got it. If he gets like a Force of Nature Savage Roar if the last card is Force of Nature, he just wins.
Yeah.
One swipe was being burned in the first burn sequence.
Okay, yeah, makes sense.
Feels like so long ago.
That game took a while, but it was a very interesting ending overall. And the fact that he actually risked the Fellow River early. Well, it didn't work out this time, but it definitely worked out many times before.
Yeah, imagine if you got one swing in with that Fell Reaver.
Yeah.
Like, that would have actually changed a lot.
Yeah, 8 damage would actually win the game right here, I think, yeah.
Well, you know, Secret Paladin and Aggro Druid. Stuff happens.
Things happen.
I do think, like, overall, Secret Paladin has an advantage. Like, it's not a good matchup for the aggressive Druid.
I think drawing Karkama, like, for example, is pretty... I think that turn where he answered, he made the Fellweaver 3-3 and then followed up with Karkama is like, yeah, you know, that's definitely going to lock a Druid down. And even after that, it was close.
Definitely. Okay, so now we are going to see this Paladin again. And this Paladin also had an interesting card, Abuse the Surgeon. What do you think about that one, Lothar?
Well, it was a card in the Secret Paladin for the first iterations of the deck, and I liked it because Paladin has so many ways to utilize the additional damage, because you have the ways of producing minions that can benefit from the buff. You have a mini-bot, which has a Divine Shield, and that's also a great way to use the buff. Some of the Secret Paladins were even playing Argent Squires, right? The beginning.
It was very, like, even lower curve than it is now. Yeah, like, very aggressive.
With Divine Favors, of course.
Yeah. All right, so we're going to see the mirror match.
And already, it looks like Athanas has the huge advantage of the combination of going first and having a Secret Keep on the board.
But he mulligans away Mrs. Chandra. I think that's a mistake. I think you should keep it every single time, even if you're going first. Because you can always play your hero power to build board advantage, and without a Mysterious Challenger on turn 6, oh, never mind.
continue. It's actually.
But I think without the Mysterious Challenger on turn 6, when you're playing a mirror match, when you're whoever has the Mystic Challenge on turn 6 and the other player doesn't have it,
yeah,
usually wins.
The thing is that if you keep Mystery's Challenger, if you lose the board early and then your opponent plays it on 5 because he has the coin, you lose. And it doesn't matter if you have Challenger or not. So I think like most of the time when you have the coin, you can keep it 100%. If you don't have a coin, you have to really think about it.
Yeah, I think it depends on your hand as well. So the Secret Keeper is really good. And if you had like Secret Keeper, Minibot Challenger or Muster Challenger, then that makes it much more like reliable in terms of building that board up. Whereas because it was just keeping a single Secret Keeper, then maybe it was a bit too risky and only a 3-card draw to draw into some of the lower curve.
Yeah.
And we see even with the Mulligan, he's got he's got turn 5, 6 and 8 sorted. He just needs the filler early on.
The filler on the 7?
Yeah. He just needs the 7. And to get to that point without being too far behind.
Oh man, playing the 1-1 actually works out for him there. Because now on turn 3 he can just avenge and play another dude.
That's sick.
Was there any worth into coining Cockhammer to kill the Secret Keeper?
Yeah, I like that a lot. You get a huge tempo swing in the upcoming 3 turns.
Yeah, and I think the second you underestimate Secret Keeper in the Paladin mirror is when you lose.
Like, well, you can't play your own secrets from hand.
Exactly.
So
and
kind of sad.
For all you know, your opponent has 3 secrets in hand, right? And it's like, it can just be crazy.
Why? Okay, that's crazy, right? Call me crazy, but that was really unexpected.
Yeah, that's not protect. Well, the Secret Keeper would still die.
I'm just trying to work out what he was actually playing around, like what the purpose of that play. Because killing Creeper can be good just to reduce the death rattle effect, but how does the death rattle effect affect you negatively when you've got that board?
Juggler, I guess.
Yeah, potentially. Juggler on 3 though feels fine. Like,
but you want to have more minions for Blessing of Kings on turn 4.
Well, yeah. You do have Avenge, so you know if your opponent starts trading, you'll be able to attack with Avenge, but then if there is a Cockhammer, as we see, it doesn't work out that well. Now well, there's a Juggler in the dude, at least.
He got the Juggler, so that's something.
Now he just needs to hit it. Yeah. Look
at Juggler this. 50-50.
The hover over. The hover over. Wow. That's definitely going to help.
Like, was he teabagging, actually?
I think he
knife chocolate teabagging a spider.
He wanted it to smell
it.
The spider.
It worked!
It works 100% time.
Oh man,
you heard it here first, guys.
We're going to see it in every tournament now.
Yeah, everyone's going to go back after tonight, go on ladder and be like, I'm just going to hover over this. I've been told it works.
60% of the time, it works every time.
Yeah.
Well, it worked right there.
Well. This is pretty nice. And like, you know, like you said, Lothar, even though he didn't coin it out, getting the Cockhammer is so good because 2 attack deals with so many of the early Paladin minions. And obviously we saw the benefit of Divine Shield sort of making your opponent like have like a really like awkward turn to try and deal with that.
Yeah. And RNA has a dream. Like, I
this
think
is getting scary.
At this point, you just have to go for face. You just need to start doing tempo stuff.
Yeah, I think you go face because there's never like an option for your opponent not to trade Shredder in here. Like, what's your opponent going to play, right? And he can't coin Challenger because of Lotheb, so that's actually huge. The benefit of having the coin to try and pull the Challenger out quicker is actually just completely negated.
It's really tough.
Yep, that's true.
So what do you do, Juggler, and shoot a minibot? I guess.
Sure. Yeah.
Well, he couldn't. Actually, could have trained.
Yeah,
now.
Would you not have gone for the clear there?
I would actually think that you trade first and then play Juggler.
Yeah.
Well, there was a small chance that it would not work. Both Juggles going to face, and then you have a 5-1 Lotheb that still deals 5 damage.
Well, you go for the Juggles when you can, right? It can win you the game.
I think the thing is, like, when you're behind and they've built up a good board with Lotheb, then you expect a Challenger. You need to play risky, because then the Challenger with a full Lotheb is now just really... What do you even do at this point? Like, your own Challenger just feels too... You've got a lot of minions, but your own Challenger just feels a bit too late now.
Well, it does block a 5-5 attack. It can actually... You can go for Lotheb and maybe try to kill it, but then like there's not really.
There's just so many things that can go wrong.
Yeah, redemption.
I suppose the only benefit that obviously we can see is that if he plays, I guess the challenge is fine, obviously, but if he didn't have the Noble Sacrifice as well, he can get Noble Sacrifice on board and then just kill this Lotheb, and then you know the 6-6 or you know the you've got Avenge, right? So it's a
You need to play the Mysterious Challenger.
Yeah,
definitely.
Because then it soaks the attack, right?
And try killing both minions, the 5/5 and 2/1, so that the 9/8
actually. Nice. Now he needs one more.
Well, he can still attack into it with the Night Juggler if things go bad. That was a miss, but
he has to attack.
Yeah, he definitely.
The drop from the Shredder, though. I mean, you're pretty okay with a 4/3.
Yeah.
Yep.
Those legs, man. Those legs.
I usually watch, like, the upper on the. Usually watch the on the upper part of the scubbies.
The horns.
Yes, exactly.
The wings. Okay. So yeah, this noble sacrifice is really going to slow Thanos down. But he does, you know, he's got plenty of options here, and he's not presented with anything too close to lethal right now anyway.
Imagine this poor guy just jumping right in, get down, and blocking 10 damage.
He gets crushed. What's more scary is imagine just muster for battle in hand. Just be like, oh, that's game. Okay, so did the Avenge go on the mini-bot there?
I think so.
Yeah, that's actually perfect. I mean, you know, the power's just spread across multiple minions. And we can see that the Aldor Peacekeeper's got... He's got an okay target in the 6/6, I guess, but that's still a hell of a lot.
By the way, Athena is playing Peacekeeper.
I knew you were going to say. I was waiting. I wanted to fly under the radar with that one, but yeah. Yeah, that is a card you can put in this deck.
Skaka was playing Peacekeeper in his own Secret Paladin as well.
Well, this draw is nice.
You can clear easily.
Yeah. You should run the 2/1 into the 3/3, the 1/5 into the 2/2.
Isn't Dr. Boom and Noble Sacrifice better? Because you have 3 juggles.
Yeah, but you can coin Blessing of Kings, one of the minions that you don't trade with, and go face, right?
Yeah.
This
game
actually looks...
Or even equip the True Silver, actually, because you gain the heal there, so you're even safer.
Yeah, definitely.
Like, you know, either or.
But I mean, it's not exactly safer. Because you want to have a more developed board anyway, right? So why don't you just go for the Blessing of Kings this turn? No, wait, actually...
Yeah, I think it's better because it's two weapon attacks over 2 turns and heal. And the thing is with Blessing of Kings, if something like Keeper of Alderman comes down, then yeah, you get the burst damage this turn, but it gets negated the following turn.
Well, even Tyrion, like...
Oh, he's going for the Blessing of Kings.
For the push.
Oh, okay.
But he needs an owl for Tyrion overall, I feel.
He can just trade.
Yeah,
but the Ashbringer is dealing a lot of damage.
Yeah, but then you have Noble Sacrifice.
You have Noble Sacrifice and True Silver Champion.
And so you can...
No, you have Noble Sacrifice and boom.
I'm just meaning get out of range over time, right?
Yeah,
you're right, actually. So basically you...
And a Belcher now, so...
You would win next turn, but you will be one of lethal.
I think this game's just over anyway.
Yeah,
because with Noble Sacrifice and Belcher and the True Silver.
How can Paladin even burst?
Yeah, because there's only Ashbringer, right?
So well, he needs Consecration to kill the
second part of Belcher.
9/1 dude.
Yeah.
Because that's what's scary.
Yeah, true.
Oh, because it doesn't even die.
Yeah. It's just that there's just so many issues now because there's so much damage on board, and then there's almost nothing in the game that can kill him from 10 health with the Noble Sacrifice. And then he has a Belcher, and then he can do Belcher True Silver next turn, and then, you know, the game's just spiraled away here, and that's actually pretty crazy.
No, that was a consideration. I mean, it can still be 8 damage from the bombs.
Yeah, well.
7 would do.
Can you buy yourself one more turn? Like, if the bomb hits face, it's over, right?
Oh my God.
Good sequencing from Athanas here to get more targets for the bombs.
Yep.
But they will hit face anyway. At least one. And that's one of lethal. Call it crazy, but that you can't attack now.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. I was going to say, he can't attack.
Oh, and he's dead. Oh. Yeah.
And to be fair, you can't not attack in that situation, right? Yeah. Like, you can't just be like, oh well, I won't attack and give him more turns to kill me on. So yeah, I mean, crazy game.
Yeah, and you cannot expect a True Silver Champion coming as well. So Arne is winning the mirror match, even though Athanas had a really good opening there.
Actually, when we talked about the True Silver Champion and Blessing of Kings, the Tyrion was the deciding factor to play Blessing of Kings instead of the True Silver Champion.
Because you don't take damage.
Yes, you don't take damage at all.
Yeah, and even the extra bonus of 1 extra health was pretty huge, yeah.
So aggressive approach was better.
Yeah. Athanas is actually going to be a little bit disappointed with that game, I think.
Well, he had the perfect curve most of
the time. Yeah, well, the thing is, he was 1-0 down, which never feels good. Mm. And then in the Paladin mirror, you start really well and look like you're just easily on top all game. Then it just swings backwards, and then suddenly he's 2-0 down and got what? He cannot lose a game now, or he gets knocked out.
Well, like, he has a warrior left?
Warlock, I think.
Warlock.
Yeah,
okay.
Warlock.
Warlock.
Yeah, so this is going to be, especially if that's Freeze Mage and this Warlock's like Zoo, for example, like, it's going to be really difficult.
And when you think about it, he got those crazy juggles right in the beginning. Like, if he wouldn't kill the spider, that would also be a huge game changer.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It must just feel really bad that it looked like, look at this. Like, it looked like everything went right. And then just over the course of like 1 to 2 turns, it just went so wrong very quickly. And that doesn't normally actually happen in Secret Paladin. Normally, whoever starts snowballing actually just continues on to win the game.
Yeah, that's right. But this game was really nice overall with that swap. Okay, so the last deck, I will have to say this is probably Zoo.
Most likely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can judge Afanas by his 2 deck choices already that he favors.
We can judge him by his deck choices. He's a terrible person. He's playing Druid in there.
Verdict is Zoo.
He plays aggro. I'm sure that this is like some sort of leper non.
Oh my
Zoo.
God. No, Murloc Zoo. Zoo. That would be so good.
So Mech Zoo?
Yeah, that could be a thing. Get those Fel Cannons. That's the card, right?
Fel Cannon. But they can't hit face, right?
Yeah. They can't hit face.
Yeah.
It's all about just tapping to get
your mech. Still, look, it's a mech, okay?
I guess.
Fel Reaver is a mech. That works.
So, which Zoo now? If this is a Zoo, if we are set on that because Lothar already judged him, is this the Leroy version? Sea Giants or Bran into Gormog?
It has to be the most obnoxious version with every single charge minion.
Wow.
Even Stuntusk Boar?
Yes.
From the Dark Petal.
Stuntusk Boar was actually played, I think, by Farabad once in a competitive match overall.
Well, it was played at the beginning in the Hunters.
Yeah.
With the
Unleash the Hounds.
Unleash the Hounds version.
Yeah.
Oh,
it was like a staple in that. Ooh, look at that. I was wrong.
Stop judging people, Lothar.
Yeah, yeah.
Lesson learned.
Stop talking at all.
Okay. Well, if this is a Reno lock, this changes things. And this will make it an okay matchup for Reno lock. It's not a. It's really close to the coin flip. But I think if Reno lock has an okay opening.
I think it's just relying on AoE more than anything.
Yeah.
You need to, like, building up, like, turn 3 or 4, you need to AoE the board down and make Mysterious Challenger a bit poor on its, you know, on its own. Because then you have follow-ups like Siphon Soul, Big Game Hunter to be able to deal with the singular Mysterious Challenger. Mm-hmm. And also, you just can't let them build up a board and keep it because then Reno doesn't heal enough, which sounds silly because it puts you onto full health. But the amount of pressure you can apply, like, you really do just need the Hellfire, the Shadow Flame, or a good Demon Wrath early on. Like we saw in the game earlier with, like, the Demon Wrath on a board full of 1-1s.
Yeah, definitely. Do you throw away Acidic Swampus, though? It's like a good minion to trade in the beginning, especially if you are able to deal with Shield Minibot.
Yeah, I think the thing is, like, you could Ooze and then, like, Ooze it Light's Justice, but as Reno Lock, you don't really care about the one damage, right?
Okay.
So I think it's better to keep hold of it and just focus on tapping early on.
You're right. So it was like he really wanted to get Demon Wrath, and he got it, so that's nice. And Bigham Hunter is also another great card for Reno Lock, because that's a great way to deal with Mysterious Challenger.
Yep. Yeah, he's definitely got a good opening hand. Even in Gang Boss, he's really good to then start trading away with the tokens with the Paladin.
Definitely. And then Arne got an okay opening himself. Like, he's able to put the early pressure.
This is sick.
Yeah, so Reno Lock has everything now. Almost.
And what's awesome here is he can actually just take the shield. Oh, okay. That's interesting. I maybe would have take the shield off the minibot, because then Must looks too good not to play, because you can ping off the Chao, and then you just Demon Wrath, and, like, just wipe the whole board.
Sure. Well, we can still do it next turn, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, he got the benefit here where he forced the trade regardless, so, you know, this is still fine.
This is perfect for Reno Lock.
And then you Demon Wrath, and then you also still have Hellfire, and then suddenly the game looks very difficult.
You don't even need Reno. Like, this is just too good.
Yeah, you just slow them down. And because of this in Gang Boss, the odds on him having something left by the time Challenger comes out to attack, to prop the Noble Sacrifice, is quite high. So then you just do that in BGH, and then Paladin's just like, yeah, okay, bro.
He's flipping the table?
Pretty much, yeah.
Double Sacrifice is quite nice here.
Is it?
Well, you do protect your 2-3.
Well, that's a Hellfire. If you really want to, like, get over with it.
True.
But it's not a good card right now. Probably just gonna tap, and that's about it.
Yeah, you're not going anywhere. As Renolog, you're happy. You dealt with the early aggression. Paladin's running out of cards.
You could go crazy here in Arcane Golem. No, listen. There's crazy logic, right?
What?
So at the moment, the Imp Gang boss has still got like causing minions on the board. You want to be able to proc Noble Sacrifice from the Challenger to Big Game Hunter it on an empty board. So you accelerate his Mysterious Challenger to then make sure the BGH lands.
Superb plan. And you like thin out his deck to ensure that he will get better draws.
And he also accelerates.
It doesn't matter. But he would have rage quit by then. That's the plan. That's the end game of that plan.
See, okay, then. No, do not care about Dr. Boom.
Weapons ready.
Shielded Minibot is actually rotating out.
Oh, too bad.
I like the
card. It just gets replaced by a 2/3 Divine Shield for 2. That'd be so funny.
Power creep.
Yeah.
The new expansion.
Mustafa Battle Summon 4/1 ones.
Oh my.
Mustafa
without
ball.
The weapon banned.
Oh yeah, it's bounce out. Oh my god.
Okay. Funny enough, I think that it will be actually be balanced.
It's more like we're laughing and it's like, oh no, that might actually work. Oh my god.
Yeah, weapon helps too much in the early game overall. Okay, so Belcher it is, and he can still continue trading.
Yeah. Trying to work out whether Hellfire feels better there, but I think Belcher's fine. Because you can't really clear everything, right? So Hellfire would have left a minion up, and if you're going to leave one, then you may as well leave a couple.
Well, Mysterious Challenger on the board where you do have minions. That feels good.
Yeah, and that's what I mean with, like, if you're going to leave, like, 1 to 2 minions up, then the effect with Mysterious Challenger is almost just as bad, right?
Was there actually any merit in going for Just Silver Champion this turn? Just Silver Champion, kill the 3/5 with this and the 1/2 attack, maybe? Then
I think he can be okay with just trading this board if he really wants to. Because then anything that attacks dies from the Noble Sacrifice. And although he loses the 2/3, the Divine Shield stays and he gets 2 more tokens. So a larger chance for the same chance for the Avenge to hit onto a minion that isn't Mysterious Challenger.
Oh man, I honestly can't see a really good way for RNA to secure this game. Just looking at the hand of Athanas.
Hellfire,
Twisting
Big
Nether,
Big Game Hunter,
Alex Traz as well.
Yeah, I like this play though. This is good. You just want to remove the big threats, or like the bigger threats, should I say? A Sludge Belcher isn't actually a big threat on its own. But this is nice. And then like even if he doesn't choose to like trade that well, Comp Spirit's gonna probably get some value as well.
True. All right, so this turn might not be the best overall. Like you cannot deal with the board unless the Avenge lands on the 3/2. So you might actually go for Sylvanas.
Yeah, I think Sylvanas is fine here.
Wait, why don't you just check for the Avenge first, and then if it lands on the 6/6, you just Big Game Hunter that.
Oh, yeah, you attack first, yeah.
Yeah. But overall, if it misses. Whoops.
What?
Yeah, the Noble Sacks in hand, right?
Yeah, but why wouldn't you attack into the 1/1 first then?
He thought there is no difference because there's obviously Noble
you
Sacrifice.
You always play around the secrets if you can, right?
Yeah, you always do that. It's like a habit you have to develop. Because someone may actually not play Noble Sacrifices, and you know.
Someone may not have it active.
I think then you look like a fool.
It actually happened in one game in the Hearthstone Champions League where Ekop attacked into Mysterious Challenger, and Ostkaka was playing only one Noble Sacrifice in the deck, and he just slammed into it with face.
Yeah. Okay, I mean, this is. Maybe this was the.
Ooh.
That tap first, mind games. But yeah, this was obviously the idea there.
Wait, what just happened?
He Hellfired.
Yeah, but why?
To clear the board.
Yeah, but you just got a 5/3, 6/3.
So I suppose, did he have a better way to clear if the Avenge didn't go on Mysterious Challenger? Then how did he kill the 6/6? And the other minions, and one of them's Avenged.
I don't know, but it looks bad now.
He wants to create a worse situation to create excitement.
I don't know, I think that Hellfire was okay from what I recall of the board state. Because if the Avenge didn't go on the Challenger, then he's in probably more trouble anyway. And there was a Comp Spirit down, right?
Did you have to attack at all?
Was it not?
No.
Well, there was 3 secrets, wasn't there?
But it could have. It would have triggered.
Yeah.
On the mini board, and it was just on the Avenge.
Yeah. Okay.
I'll just slam Sylvanas last turn. That's not Avenge. Sorry.
Well, now we just heal. You get 9 damage to the face. Now it's competitive spirit, though. No, wait, it's not.
No, he played the Noble Sacrifice from hand, right?
Yeah,
so it was repentance
right.
That was the missing secret.
Yeah. Is this enough damage? Not really.
No, that's 11.
11.
11, but your opponent doesn't have a way of... Like, use... Do you use the...
Twisting Nether. Twisting Nether, yeah, yeah, you
and
do.
And then you Alexstrasza yourself next turn?
Yeah, I think. Why not? For justice. Twisting Nether is quite good here. If you cannot deal with the 5-3, you have to do something about it.
Yeah. Especially because you use the weapon as well now. Like,
yeah, yeah.
I think like it's almost definitely guaranteed that you made the play now because the weapon's gone.
Yeah, and you have an answer for a possible Tyrion. I mean, like, it will be late if the Tyrion hits next turn, but Sylvanas played preemptively will answer the Tyrion overall. So Twisting Nether just to remove a 5-3 and a dude. Because you have
5-3 with Divine Shield, though, so that's worth a bit more, right?
Yeah, it's...
Depends on where the sound like. And plus, we get to see an awesome animation.
Is there a card that can just win right now? No, Paladin will not be able to burst
Leroy.
Before.
Out of nowhere.
This is not a deck that plays Leroy. He does play...
We didn't think he'd play Abusive Sergeant, yeah. Man.
You think there's a Leroy there?
Hey, look, look. We'll see.
Well, he's not out of the woods yet. Alexstrasza.
It's actually... Four damage next turn at least.
Well,
right?
But Alexstrasza is kind of saving him here.
He puts him to 11. Is there any reason? Yeah, you just Alexstrasza.
Yeah, there's not a way. You don't have any taunts.
Yeah, either way,
you're dead on board, so kind of.
You probably heal. Yeah, it's probably a good play,
probably
right?
Probably a good play to heal.
Paladin is pressuring so hard here.
Oh,
Master.
That's okay. You've seen Hellfire and Demon Wrath, right?
Yep.
So you've seen two AoEs and Twisting Nether. With Twisting Nether. So
Sunny Shadow Flame.
This is and you know what? If he's Alexstrasza himself, he doesn't have Reno. Because there's no way you wouldn't Reno over Alexstrasza.
Well,
unless
not yet.
You play one double copy of something and he didn't draw.
He's like, oh man, look at that top deck. He can destroy the weapon.
That's actually heal for four.
Deny
over
four damage.
Turns. Yeah, it's like it's like a dot, but it's not damage. It's heal, so it's hot.
It is actually relevant.
I want to
see. Hot is healing over time, kind of. So
yeah, that's what I said.
I want to see the dice roll on the mind control tech to steal the 1-2 taunt here.
And deal damage to the face.
He's going for it.
It's noble sacrifice, wow, he's right?
He's teabagging again.
Oh!
So this
works
is
50% of the time.
Wait.
50% still good, right?
Yeah.
It's five damage still only. And you can play Arcane Golem to kill the 1-2.
Is it Noble Sacrifice now? I'm getting so confused with these secrets.
No, yeah.
He's not attacked yet, right?
Yeah, okay.
I kind of like Sylvanas. Because, like, so far...
Those Noble Sacrifices, man. They bought, like, 18 damage this game. This match.
Yeah.
Well, Paladin cannot win this yet. Like, he can, on top, get 4 damage, being Blessing of Kings.
So he wanted to play the Ooze, so that's why he played the low tab, but I think I would have just favored Sylvanas there.
Yeah, me too.
Well, so why? You can just die to Blessing of Kings. Or
you can die to Blessing of Kings anyway, it's 9 mana.
No,
right?
You can't.
It's
couldn't.
9 damage.
There was 9 damage. Wait, I was 5 on board, right?
Yeah, so Blessing of Kings is on 9.
Yeah, and if he would not Ooze, then it will be 10. Okay, so yeah, still. You're right. Sylvanas was a bit better.
I mean, was it? She won't die anyway, right?
Yeah, I just mean like the low tab effect doesn't change anything from a top deck, right?
Anyway, Reno Jackson will be top deck right now.
Reno Jackson, Cypher,
oh, that's
good enough.
Yeah, it can save him, but it's funny because he needs to trade with those minions, and Paladin is still dealing damage. Shadow Flame would be amazing as well. It's also an out. Do you tap into Shadow Flame? Well, you definitely Cypher Soul. One of them, probably 3-2, and then you tag into 2 1-1s, and there is how much damage? 3 damage left. So you are safe. Unless Divine Favor.
I was wondering, was it better to Siphon Soul the Divine Shield? So you'd lose one minion, but gain the 3 attack. So maybe it'll be faster.
You're right.
To actually just, you know, gain that 3 attack immediately as opposed to the potential stacking of 3 attacks over multiple turns.
Actually, he's thinking about going for face, and I like
it. I think you have to.
Yeah, you're not dead to afford plus 4 damage.
Yeah, he's just not dead next turn. Like, he's just not.
And, can
and he has so many, like, he's got Arcane Golem for some additional burst.
Can he get a kill next turn then? This is 9.
He can
17, 20. Yeah,
oh.
That. Yeah, definitely, if nothing is being killed.
Yeah, this is game for the Paladin now, right?
12, 17,
because he's trading the minions, so he's never going to push the Warlock hard enough.
Yeah, well, he has lethal in hand, basically. Like, Warlock has lethal. Like, even after trading, there's basically Arcane Golem.
Yep.
16. Yep, enough. And you know, this is... you face double noble sacrifice, but just in case. So this means that Althanas is still alive with his Reno Walk.
Now it all depends what kind of decks did Arneej bring.
Yeah, because suddenly, like, you know, Reno Lock versus a Freeze Mage, I think it's not too bad for the Reno Lock.
It's
if
not.
If it's played, like, it's not amazing. You can still, you know, it's not like a sure thing, but I think it's definitely okay as long as you can manage your resources properly.
Which decks?
Reno Lock versus, say, Freeze Mage.
Yeah, it's good for Reno Lock, possibly.
Yeah.
And then if there is a Zoo, that's also good for Reno Lock. So maybe this Reno Lock is positioned perfectly to win this match.
Yeah, so really cool, really. Yeah, another like really close game as well. Like it's pretty crazy the fact that you know that just showcased what Secret Paladin can be like towards late game, where you're literally top decking cards that just don't have any real impact on the board unless you get into those Dr. Boom or Tyrion or you know like even like a Shredder or something. But when you top deck like a Creeper,
yeah, but honestly, Raven, it was closer than it should have been because like looking at that start, Zombie Chow into M Gangbus into Demon Wrath into. Actually, that Hellfire was a bit iffy in one moment where Mr.
Yeah,
Shadow
I wasn't sure. That
yeah,
the Hellfire
this moment where the minibot came out.
Yeah. But overall, like the start was amazing for the Reno Lock, and it seemed that there is no chance that Paladin can come back. But Paladin kept being really close, near killing Althanas.
Yeah, Alex Straza actually saving the day there because Reno decided to just not show up for work for this match. So
imagine if you would play Jiraxxus instead.
Same outcome.
Mostly.
Yeah, it would have just been over quicker, wouldn't it? Because you can spawn the 6/6 and attack with a weapon.
Yeah, that's case, I guess.
Yeah. That would actually spiral
would
be a better.
You prop the Noble Sacrifice the turn you play Jiraxxus, right? So.
Yep.
Imagine if he isn't playing Reno. He's like, wow. Alex Straza healed to 15.
What a hipster. I'm just playing one-offs because I like it. I don't play Reno Jiraxxus.
Yeah, I just like the challenge. Alex Straza healed me to 15.
Well, the Raven, we did face that before. Remember Strifecrow's Reno Lock without Reno?
Oh yeah. We
had three or four games when Strifecrow was playing Reno Lock, and he just never got Reno.
He just didn't draw it.
Well, maybe he didn't have it. Did you ask him?
He did have it. We saw it in the fifth game.
I think. It was really like, and then the game he drew it, he didn't need it. So it's just
like he never needed it. Actually, he was winning with that deck.
Yeah, it's crazy.
And Althanas, well, he might not be needing the Reno as well. But it's useful versus most of the matches. Like, you mostly mulligan for Reno in the aggro matchups as well.
Yeah, I think it's okay. I think it's like, it's a tough one because as we saw earlier, like, a deck like Shaman can just beat you on turn 5, so it doesn't matter.
But okay, it's Freeze Mage.
And this is the more of the standard Freeze Mage and not Laughing's List that we saw Crane play at the start. Of today? Or was that yesterday? Yep. Wow.
That was the beginning of
yesterday.
The
Swiss, right? Yeah, it's all blending into one. So this is the more standard version with Antonidas in, and that's like, you know, one of the win conditions of you just cycle into more fireballs. Whereas the deck Crane was playing just had more like direct burn and probably, I think, more card draw as well.
And it would probably be a bit better versus Reno Lock because this matchup is all about sustaining yourself. So Freeze Mage will try to kill Reno with Burst, and Reno will try to never give Freeze Mage a chance.
Yep.
So keep yourself healthy at 30. After Alexstrasza, play Reno to get back to 30, and if they and deal with Alexstrasza, so you need to have some kind of board pressuring the Freeze Mage.
Yep.
But overall, you should be able to win in Fatigue, where Freeze Mage just runs out of burn cards, and it's Fatigue. Which doesn't actually.
I think what the Freeze Mage needs to do here is actually really get the best Emperor off they can, and then threaten like lethal from like 18-ish health or 17 health.
Yeah.
So then it forces like a bit of an awkwardish Reno, and then you Alexstrasza. But getting that pressure on without burning too much of your spells is definitely going to be tough.
Infinite fireballs, basically, right?
Oh, that was the Reno too.
Yeah, I mean with like a good Thanos and, you know, like Frostbolt, Ice Lance with maybe a Fireball, like, that's a lot of damage. It's just getting to the point where they feel forced into Reno as opposed to getting a really good, like a Reno from 10 health or something is insane versus a Reno from nearly 20.
The question is also like, does Arne actually play a Pyroblast or is this the no Pyroblast version? I think Pyroblast is becoming a real standard.
Yeah, I think it's becoming super standard, yeah. What's a tough part for the Reno lock actually is that a lot of the cards aren't that relevant against Freeze Mage. So the AoEs, for example, they're so powerful. We saw versus Paladin, suddenly you're a bit like dead cards. And the second you sat with dead cards, and you can only tap for so long in Reno, so it can be a little bit rough.
Twisting Nether on empty board, I've seen that.
Yeah, we have seen like six Twisted Metal.
Oh god, please. Yeah. Please, I don't need the reminders.
Lord Walker Cho. In one game.
Yep. That's well, the Marina Jackson can actually pressure Freeze Mage with this opening.
Yeah, but on the other hand, like, do you really want to play it on six? You want to keep it versus Lextraza. And versus Freeze Mage, most of the time, just pressuring them is so awkward. Because you do try to have some action on board, and then you get locked out, you lose your board, and Freeze Mage is still in a good position.
But you have to win at some point. Somehow.
That's right, that's right. And actually, this Reno Alok has a good win condition, which is Arcane Golem, Faceless, and PO. So can deal a lot of damage out of nowhere. So you don't need to get Mage to, like, 10 health or whatever. You can actually pop the block from... what, 16, is it?
Yeah, like the average is 16 standard, I guess, because you know you're removing things like the Dark Peddler giving you another PO and things like that. I think you just have to go for the pretty standard Arcane Golem, one PO and Faceless.
There is a Torch, though. I like the fact that Torch is actually back in the decks.
Interesting.
I think you just play the Doomsayer this turn.
I think it's rough because you're not under any immediate, like, massive pressure at the moment because you've still got quite a high health total on the Seekro.
But you want to play Emperor next turn, right?
Not yet, I think.
Why not? You have Frostbolt, Icelands, and Fireball in hand. I think you can generate Fireballs if you draw Antonidas.
Yeah, but I think you would want to wait to have more cards. Like, you're not in a rush, are you?
Yeah, it's a tough one. I think it's really difficult. It really does just depend on how the game plays out here and, like, when that Reno is used. But I think you really want to push for a super strong Emperor. And now maybe you can just Frost Nova Doomsayer if he really feels like it.
I think Blizzard is fine. Or, like, not even... You might even just maybe ping and pass to get more value out of those cards. It's only 7 damage.
Yeah, I just think like I think the Frost Nova Doomsayer is like reasonable because you're not too bothered about them being reduced. But the issue here is that the Mage is just missing card draw.
Yeah, that's the big problem. It's not getting the cycle.
I told there's no Acolyte we've seen. We've seen Mad Scientist thin the deck of one card by drawing the Secret. But there's no like Loot Hoarders or Novice Engineers, depending on what he's playing. So
Arcane Intellect.
Yeah, no Arcane Intellect, which is huge. So, you know, this is not the position you want to be in versus Reno because they have more cards than you and they'll continue to do so.
Yeah, that's why I think you have to take the damage like a man because you don't have enough to be able to stall this game. You just need to draw things. And if you spend if you spend Nova and Doomsayer this turn or Blizzard, you will run out of those cards when it matters, when there is like more damage than 7 on board.
And there's the combo as well. So he does have it in hand. You know, hasn't had it reduced or anything, so we're not going to see it for a few turns yet. But just having it available is actually pretty huge because the Mage is the only real answer to like popping a block quite early. Is like trying to get an Alexstrasza down to Selfiel or like just Ice Block, Ice Barrier, and then hoping you know you can't proc that through 8. But as we can see on the board now, this you know 7 damage a turn is actually really going to stack up pretty quickly.
Yeah, absolutely. And the combo like might be the free card combo, but you can also just use the power overall and make Arcane Golem to pop the block if possible. And
yeah, like you pretty much pop the block as soon as possible. I don't think. Yeah. And also that we've seen, I believe this weekend, is Faceless on Antonidas.
Yeah, is a thing. That works.
Yeah, so when you get the Warlock with unlimited fireballs, it gets kind of scary.
Sounds a bit hilarious. We actually saw that.
Wait. Yeah, that's what I was saying. Yeah, we saw it earlier.
Yeah, yeah.
We had trouble counting lethal because we didn't assume that
we're
Warlock
like,
can get the fireballs.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Compute at all.
Makes no sense. Must quit.
Whoa, so we might get a second PO here. Which won't do too much, actually, because he's already in range. Of popping with just the combo.
Definitely.
The only issue with popping with just the combo, for example, is you pop them on 8, right?
You can't
bring them lower, but the next attack's going to be important.
Actually, it's not even about the PO. Like, for next, if he gets even like an Elven Archer from the Dark Peddler, he will.
I did not expect you to talk about that card.
Just but the there's always ball control, so.
Yeah.
So, boar is also good. Like, basically, he will just need one more damage next turn to pop the block. If there is nothing being done.
Let's go, Blizzard. Falnose Blizzard, let's go. We need that cycle.
Yeah, I like Fallen. Oh man, this is so tough. This is such a bad position for Arne.
I think the problem is, in a perfect world for the mage, you'd want Thanos reduced and then do big spell damage burst.
Yeah.
But it's not a perfect world. Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I completely agree with this. You value the cycle way more than the spell power. You don't even really care too much about killing off the Argus that the spell power gives there. You just just want the cycle and to slow this attack down.
Oh man, Lothab is also great after you pop the block. Or maybe you can even pop the block and Lothab the same turn.
Are there any like big impact one mana cards that aren't like PO or Soulfire? But in versus Freeze Mage, I don't think there's anything too crazy. Really. Dragon Egg's okay, actually. I don't mind Dragon Egg.
Clockwork Gnome.
Squire is one damage that's actually that can maybe stay on board and will help you to deal one damage that's missing. Or is it missing now? Like the situation's changed a bit. Clockwork Gnome can be troublesome because you get a spare part and you can burn a card.
Oh, and what the? I really like the Sylvanas play.
But you can get a switch, and you can switch a Doomsayer, or you can switch an all minion because it has more HP to attack, get additional burst.
The Sylvanas is so good because at this point in the game, like for him to come back, you're really expecting something crazy with Antonidas, or you know Alexstrasza coming down and pressuring that way. But like Sylvanas is just like, yep, yeah, play a minion, like play one.
This turn we'll see Doomsayer on board, Roaring. No, wait, that's Roaring Torch. That's 6 damage. Okay, then never mind. I was thinking that's the smaller torch, but you can still get your opponent to steal the Doomsayer and get it.
Yeah, and clear the board.
Can he go for the burst? Like, this is 5, 12,
I don't think he can afford
16
to.
Damage.
I think he might have to do the board clear play.
If you deal 17, no, you'll not have enough.
Well, you can use Frostbolt. Interesting. But you probably would like to keep it for the Iceland, because Frostbolt has 4 damage right now, so you can. Frostbolt the Sylvanas, sacrifice the Falnos, play Doomsayer, ping Sylvanas.
Yeah, I like that. It removes a lot of damage off the board. And you just can't leave Sylvanas up, right? Like, you just
the only
can't.
Problem is that you remove yourself from with the Frostbolt, and you would like to keep the Frostbolt for Antonidas.
I think Fireball is the best one, because the torch is cheaper and does the same job. Yeah. And like you said, the Frostbolt Ice Lance is really, really powerful. So you get the sort of fancy, fun play. Of you know, forcing your opponent into a Doomsday so it clears the board this turn.
He knew it.
He knew it.
He was ready.
The problem now is like he started to use Burn to deal with the board, which is okay, but he's still not seen Reno, and he's not even close to bringing the Warlock low enough to even use it, and he's still not seen a heal bot.
Yeah, definitely.
So this is just looking this is looking pretty rough actually.
But on the other hand, like we don't have the kill yet. Like he can pop the block, but it doesn't matter. So you want to get your opponent lower for sure.
I don't know. Would you not pop the block?
Probably not. Like being at 16, like what does it give you? You can actually trap your opponent. Like if you play minions now, and if you're able to get the mage lower and then pop the block and play Lotham on the same turn, you will just lock them. And here, just charging 16 to face would not achieve anything. I think Zombie Chow is fine this turn as well.
I don't think it's needed though. Zombie Child, the only thing it's going to do that's okay is actually kill off the Ice Barrier armor. But other than that, you don't need it. Look at the positioning. He's still got Reno. He's still got Dart Bomb for additional damage. I think it's fine here.
Well, I guess this is the turn when you play Emperor. Yeah. Fortunately for Arneesh, he didn't draw a single Arcane Intellect, single.
Acolyte
of Pain.
Loot Hoarder. Or Novice.
Yeah. So.
Or anything.
That kind of sucks.
Yep.
Like, the only card draw he did get is Mad Scientist, although it's very valuable because it draws a card and plays it already.
It's not multi-card draw, so. Yeah. He's only drawn one of those, right? He's got the other one in hand now, but, you know, like, so up to this point.
Interesting. Yeah.
And also, no Alexstrasza, so he can't even, like, kind of. Hope his opponent doesn't have Reno, Alexstrasza then kill over the two turns.
Yeah. Well, he had an option to burst Warlock down, but there is Reno Jackson, so that would not work. And it's good that he didn't take that line. But it's a bad matchup to begin with, and he ended up with a terrible draw as well.
Or a lack of.
Yeah.
Lack of draw overall.
Lack of draw overall. Well, definitely.
He just didn't draw, so that's definitely a problem.
So, what can we see now? There's only 4 cards. I think Athanas is in such a great position that he can do whatever. Only 4 cards there.
I think you just would like to pop the block this turn, right?
Not necessarily. There's only four cards for mage, and he will not burst you down from 23. I would not even hate like going for face and then the twisting nether.
Faceless the Emperor. Let's go.
Oh, that would actually be pretty cool.
Would that change much?
You can faceless the Emperor, and because using faceless, you can PO the Squire and just kill his Emperor. Because then your combo's not a combo anymore if you've used faceless, right?
Yeah, that's true.
And you're in such a demanding position, and the value you get from having your own emperor that the mage has to answer. So that would need, like, what, flame strike hero power or a direct burn spell. And again, the more direct burn is used on minions, the more secure you are with Reno Sever.
That's true.
He's going to go for the Demon Wrath instead, though, and just leave his two minions up. Probably just follow up with, like,
Oh,
I just like Shredder.
Yeah,
Shredder is just a sticky minion that's good. Like, you want a Lotheb on like a key turn, and this just isn't a key turn. Because now Alexstrasza could be, although not scary because he has Reno, but Alexstrasza is a play, right? You know, this turn.
I just like Lotheb in a situation when you're like sealing the deal.
Just to lock definitely.
Just lock the mage out, yeah. Kind of interesting.
Well, he probably played Lotheb because he wants to get deeper near the ice block, and there is an ice barrier now, so he felt like he wants more power on board to be able to pop that block, just to go through all the armor and actually pop the block this turn. Yeah. Because there is, what, 23 at the moment with the ice barrier. So he has 16, and with this he can pop the block easily on 1. And then he has a passable Dark Bomb.
So,
I think you do pop the block now. You combo out and get them on 1.
This is actually interesting. Have we seen an... Is there still an Ice Lance and a Frostbolt in the deck?
Wait, what?
Is there still an Ice Lance and a Frostbolt in the deck?
Yes.
Yeah, he has...
Well, look at the amount of damage he has in one turn because of the reduction.
7,
well,
plus...
6, 9, 13... Wait, what am I talking about?
No.
So 12,
he 12.
15,
yeah, it's like, no, it's definitely more than 13. Like,
it's 19 damage.
So, if he top decks an Ice Lance, he's actually winning this.
Yeah.
Can he get a Fireball and still cast it? That's 5, 6, yeah. Have he used the Fireball?
He
played one Fireball.
Yeah, he's already used one, so it really is the Ice Lance.
Frostbolt
oh,
also
Frostbolt Ping, right?
And Ping, yeah, Frostbolt Ping would be enough. Oh, wow. And
so, hang on, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Well, it's
yeah,
an exciting attack
it.
Here, but the Freeze Mage can actually still win this.
This is actually nuts, like... And this is the issue where like the Freeze Mage gets enough of an Emperor off where you're not going to Reno on 23, right? Because especially not seeing Alex yet.
Can he get the burn card? That will work.
Ooh.
No! See, he still has a chance.
But he can, yeah, no. He can ping the Acolyte and Ice Block.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. And play Reno? Would you just play Reno to seal the deal? I guess you can. No, like you haven't seen Alexstrasza.
Oh my god, this is actually.
Oh man,
insane.
So this all comes down to Athanas making a read. How much damage is there in the hand?
The problem is, like. So the thing here is, he doesn't have the mana to do other things. So it's not like, oh, his hand's definitely full of burst because he didn't cast anything. But this is a hard call. Like, would you guys honestly play the Reno here?
I would play it.
From your point of view?
Yeah, I would
play
it.
He's sitting...
you popped two ice blocks.
You've seen the fireball as well. Yeah. You've seen the fireball. So it's like...
If this rolls for 4, he cannot play Reno.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man. This is...
Oh, my God. He just died.
Oh.
He just died. Yeah. He doesn't see it.
Wait, he's not... Oh.
No, he doesn't see it.
Oh, my God.
Arnie got it.
Wow.
Oh, my God. Woo. He actually got it from this position versus the Reno lock.
And
he got the ice even more.
He can do it all.
It's even more. Oh, my God. My. So much burst.
Wow.
Can Athanas believe it? He's like, oh, my God. He has it. Does he have it? Is it even possible
Stack
to die from
up.
This amount
oh
of health?
Oh, my God. He needs to finish with the Ice Lance, right?
Full burn.
just for... No, Ice Lance!
Ping!
Oh
and Arne!
Well...
Wins the match and advances to top 8, doubles the money.
Yep, that was so harsh. You had the answer to your problems, but you just didn't play it.
Yeah, so this is actually something we saw from... Or the opposite of what we saw from Amnesiac in the NA prelims, where he was making plays that looked really weird, because it's like, you can just win, right? But what he was doing was he was making the safest play to ensure that there is no lost chance every turn. And like the Reno play was a similar turn there where he could have played it and been back to full health and just made it 30 damage.
Raven, allow us to congratulate the winner.
Hi, dude.
Thank you.
Congrats.
So, Arne, that's how you say your nickname, right? Arne?
Yes.
All right, Arne.
Okay, I was telling Arne. So
yeah, a
sorry.
Lot of people pronounce it differently. Yeah.
So that was a very impressive series overall, because obviously the burst from Freeze Mage was great, and it was great seeing it on the big screen. But then your Paladin versus Paladin was really impressive there.
Yeah, I had to take some risks there, because like he had a 10-9 Challenger, and if he had a weapon, he would win. So yeah.
That was a good call, though. Yeah. So, yeah.
Remind me, what was your placement in Krušnapoka? Was it?
It was top 16 as well.
Top 16.
Yeah, now,
yeah. Now, it's top 8. Yeah, now it's well. Top 8.
And that's making improvements.
So Romania is really your land, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Definitely. All right. Was there anything else like that Freeze Mage game? It looked really bad, but you did turn around.
I missaw something in the first game. I thought his last two cards were Druid of the Claw and Savitror, so I thought it was that. That's why I was shaking my head. So.
Yeah, okay. Because it was like the last innervate, right? Yeah.
But I really thought it was Druid of the Claw, so I was like, fuck.
To be honest, like I think Lothar was the only one who knew it's innervate. Yeah. And I thought it's what? I thought it's swipe, and you thought it's...
I just put my hands up and said I didn't know what it was. I was like straight up.
Yeah, I really thought it was Druid of the Claw. But
well, it's really hard to keep track.
When there are cars being burned and you don't see the animation happening, it's kind of hard to keep track what is being burned.
Like, there's a Fel Reaver on turn 3. You basically do not think that the game will go to fatigue.
How did you feel in that last game? Like, did you... Because we could see that there was, like, say, as you can see now, there was, like, Reno in hand and everything.
Oh, he had Reno in hand.
Yeah, he had Reno. Should have played. So, did you think you were as behind as you were? Like for most of that game, because you just drew no card draw, right? You drew no Acolyte and
cycle. I kind of like I think in the corner of his eye, he saw me shaking my head, and I was doing that just
on purpose.
Yeah,
yeah.
Nice bluff.
The mind games.
I don't
real.
Know if that made a difference, but yeah.
Well, honestly, like if you look at your health pool, you have 23 and you have Reno in hand. I would really consider also not playing it.
Yeah, if you pop the second ice block, you should definitely play it, I think.
To be there, super, super safe, right? Because even if you play Alexstrasza, it doesn't make a difference at all.
Definitely. All right, so not playing that Reno, but on the other hand, he really felt the blood. Like he felt like, I won this, I've got this, right? Yeah. So then like he wasn't thinking about protecting himself, especially because he was at 23. But mathematically, correct decision was to play Reno there. But then, that was a really impressive series. Starting for that Paladin versus Druid, where there was the Fel Reaver, you really dealt with it pretty well. And then the Paladin, and the Reno versus what was the first the one you lost?
I lost Paladin versus Reno, right?
Paladin versus Reno,
Paladin versus.
That was actually also very close.
Yeah, it was pretty close, but in the end, I had to like. Throw everything face and hope he doesn't have heal or something. Mm-hmm. But he had Alexstrasza.
Well, you top decking with Paladin and just need to
you need
deal
to
the
get
damage.
Your big minions,
All right, so we do have our top 8. This means we do have our top 8, and Arne, you're part of the top 8. I'm sure if we have the bracket ready already with all the members. It might not be ready yet, but from memory then, guys. Wait. Okay, it's here. So. Thais versus Powder will open tomorrow. They will face each other. Then Moody versus Unid, Janet Druid, and Scruffy, and then Tracky Style versus Arne. Are you ready for the Fist Shaman Madness, Arne?
I'm not sure yet. I'll think about it.
Well, now you can spend some time, although it's really late here. It's 11:20 p.m. But you have time to think about your lineup and bring it tomorrow, right? You can still change it.
We can change the lineup afterwards. So the lineup you bring now.
Yeah, it's for the rest of the day,
Mm-hmm. So I can go safe for top 4 if I completely counter him, but then I might not make it top 1.
You are aiming for top 1 or are you just making for top 4?
I'm just trying to get as far as I can, of course. Okay. Yeah.
By the way, I just wanted to say that our cameraman is actually playing Hearthstone.
At the moment. Definitely. Everybody plays Hearthstone. Hearthstone's a good game overall.
Commitment, guys. Commitment.
Watching Hearthstone playing Hearthstone is great. Okay, so
Right now, he's playing right now.
I know he's playing right now. I see it. But the viewers can't see it at the moment. I think we don't have like, our cameraman's phone on the feed. But so you guys will not see it, but you have to believe us. Okay, so that was day 2. We still have one more day with all those amazing matches. We'll have 8 matches tomorrow, I believe. So the top 4.
7.
7 matches.
Yes.
7 matches, with the final. And, we are fighting for some good prizes. Do you guys remember what's the first place prize?
8K and 15 points.
15 points. That's a lot. And Arne, you're getting 2 HCD points already. So you're closer to being qualified for the spring prelim.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to try to get in the preliminaries.
Do you have any points already? Like legend this month?
Yeah, I won a cup and I'm legend, so...
Oh, wow. Okay. So it's like 4 points, six. So you're probably already qualified if the six will be the...
Yeah, but it's 3 months now. So the previous one was 2 months. So 3 months might be a bit more points.
Definitely.
Got plenty of time, though.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. So that's really cool, guys. Do you have any questions for Arne?
No, I guess our players should get prepared for tomorrow, right? So we don't want to waste his time.
Yeah, just congratulations and get some sleep. Yeah.
All right. Okay. So that was an amazing day with a lot of great plays, a lot of great decks, fast matches, long matches, and a lot of great players. Eight players fallen down, but they got $500 at least in their pockets. So they will be happy about that. And eight players advanced, they will be facing each other tomorrow. I think from me, from Lothar, from Raven, and from Arne, that will be it for today. So thank you so much for watching, and see you guys tomorrow same time.